Okay. Oh, that's good. Okay. Welcome to the year, the animated year in review, or however I wrote it in the program book. My name is Mark McPherson. I am a film critic for moviespoon.com. So I've watched every animated film that's come out in the last year since Detour. I've also written the books, The Great Animated Movies, and a book on video game movies. So I love nothing more than writing about movies. So that's why we're on the panel to talk about them.
And I'm Ryan. I'm a freelance journalist. I've written quite a bit of reviews in the past on many animated films of all kinds. Just got a great big love for them, you know. And I would just love to bring, and I'm just here to bring that kind of love to a panel of some kind.
I'm Brittany Hecker. I'm a huge film buff in general. It was my minor at UMD, graduated English major. Most of the writing that I do is just ranting on the internet whenever I see like a problematic post or something like that. But animated movies have like a really close place in my heart. Just always been a fan of children's literature. So.
All right. Well, from what I understand, most of us have seen every film since the last Detour.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm wondering how many people, because barely anyone saw this at all. So we'll start right at the top.
Oh yeah, this one.
Ratchet and Clank.
I did not have the guts to watch this one.
I don't blame you for not seeing Ratchet and Clank.
I couldn't
because
do it.
Nobody saw Ratchet and Clank.
Like was it, like yeah like. I know, like,
I know,
poor, that's
I didn't,
poor advertisement
I didn't
there
see
for
trailers.
One.
Not only was it poor advertisement, it was confusing advertisement because they released it the same time as the PS4 game. And I couldn't tell if they were advertising the game or the movie because they were using the same engine and the same 3D materials.
No, it was like a mess from the start. Jeez.
Yeah. The train wreck.
That, oh, we'll blend it with the game and the movie and they'll connect.
You know, you'd think that would get, like, the gamers involved, but it didn't get anybody.
No.
Well, gamers in like these films and stuff, and like video games and like films based off of video games and stuff, like I feel like it never really entices them to actually as an incentive to like go see those films though.
It's a very niche crowd, and that crowd very rarely goes out to see those type of films. Cause like, yeah, like most gamers I know would just go to like superhero films and stuff like that. They really don't want to go out because they figure it's probably going to be a cheap production and they'll see it when it comes on Netflix or they'll just torrent it.
Most likely.
Well, either or, I guess maybe torrenting a little bit more, but...
I'm sure some of them also would just like to actually play, like, a game instead of, like, just go see a movie based off of the game.
Yeah.
With an hour and 40-minute, like, time constraint.
Yeah,
pretty much.
Unless it gives you extra content, like, something more to their story that they've built up over 10 years. Mm-hmm. If it's just a regurgitation, most people are like, what? Like, when they've redone the Silent Hill movies 3,000 times, people are like, don't. Just stop.
Well, it's one of those things where they try to appeal to the fans now because a lot of like video game studios now have become their own movie studios, and they will try to appeal to the fans as much as they can, believing that's all they need to do. And for most of the fans, that is all they need to do. And that's because like Ratchet and Clank, it seems like I haven't played the games, but it seems like there's a lot of in jokes put in here that I am not quite grasping. I mean, there's some like meta humor that's trying to like, you know, like trying to play with or like make fun of itself. Like, oh, the villain's monologue is going to come in 3, 2, 1. And then the monologue actually starts. I guess that's funny. It really didn't attract anyone because, again, it's entirely for fans of the game. And it really didn't have any big names. I mean, the biggest names it had attached to the voice cast was like Paul Giamatti and Sylvester Stallone and John Goodman.
Mm-hmm.
Just like usual voice actors that we get. We're still talking about video game movies.
I know.
The other movie is the Angry Birds movie, which...
Who would have thought?
My cousins were hyped about. My little cousins were like, yay, hi.
Right, because... Yeah, I mean, like, we talk about how, like, Ratchet and Clank was niche. Angry Birds was very mainstream. Mm. So this was kind of a good investment. The problem was the film was made by Sony. And and Sony is, like, at this point in the timeline, Sony is, like, in kamikaze mode. Because with Angry Birds, I don't know, like, something must have filtered in the water with the people who made the games because they decided to sink all their money into this. I think the marketing budget on Angry Birds movie was, like, $300 million.
Oh God!
And the movie cost $86 million to make, so they spend three times as much marketing this film. And I mean, it made good money, but none to like rationalize spending $300 million on a campaign with McDonald's to rationalize. The most positive thing I've heard about the film was that somebody looked at the trailer and they said, oh, it looks like a movie. I was like, I don't know about this man. No, it looks like a movie. Well, yeah, the most base requirement would be that it looks like a movie. and for, I'll be honest, like when the film first started in the first act, I had high hopes for it because they established the society where all birds are happy and there is few birds who are trying to deal with their anger and how they don't fit in. It's like, okay, this could work. Then they bring in the pigs and then the movie turns into Minions. It literally, because then it just turns into pig puns and dance numbers.
Jokes that don't flow together whatsoever.
And lots of fart jokes. And then by the end, by the third act, they've given up. They've just, say like, oh, now we're going to have birds be shot out of a slingshot at the pig's castle. Why? Because that's what happens in the game. They immediately jump to that conclusion that that's what they have to do.
I know, just such a weird movie, such a weird conception behind it, you know. I just can't, it's hard for me to conceive it.
You know, I think it's hard when you have merchandising already. Like, most movies right. build their merchandising afterwards, but we have Angry Birds, which has merchandising through Target, through Walmart, through Hot Topic, mm-hmm. everywhere in pre-existence. So they're like, oh, we can sink money into this because we already have money coming in from this. So let's just go for it.
But then you just put like the pressure on the writers to make all of that like yeah. make sense in the end and for all of it to gel together, and it must be like the most stressed writer's room ever.
Yeah. It's especially kind of surprising because it was written by a few of the people who've like written on like The Simpsons before. Like, some very, very good writers were on this. The problem is that there were a couple different writers on it. So, you know, you put too many writers in there, it usually either means there's conflicting visions or people left. So it's one or the other, and I knew that was going to come back to it, because it does seem like somebody had a real idea for Angry Birds being about anger management, and then someone just wrote in, like, Green Minions, and that became the movie. Are we going to go next to Finding Dory?
Oh, yes.
Little depressing to see it, mainly because Finding Nemo is, like, my favorite Pixar movie in terms of writing. And Finding Dory is more or less just rehashing the same story. I mean, they find a few themes that are a little bit more explored, like, you know, mostly dealing with, you know, disabilities, which is kind of handled nicely. But it's essentially the same story and nothing really broke out of it to me. Especially, like, I was hoping that, like, Ed O'Neill would really impress me as voicing, like, the octopus. Because I like him and he does an okay job. But I never really felt like I got a moment where he really stuck as a character for me.
I feel like it worked. I mean, I feel like it was supplemented with like enough like good like visual humor, you know.
I know, like that, like that's why I'm kind of angry with this movie, because I'm like, it's just good.
It's good. I think it's partially good because it does struggle with like some of the disability stuff. Like, bringing that to light, like something I've heard in a lot of panels is the representation matters, no matter where it is and what it's from. Like, yeah, at its core, some of it can be bad, some of it can be good. But this is like from a major like movie standpoint, like not only investing in these characters and the representation, like showing that to children, like kids going to see this movie. Mm-hmm. And you have kids that have like maybe their autism spectrum, maybe they have like the same memory issue, but they're watching this and they're seeing this struggle and they can empathize with this struggle.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I can agree to that.
I just wish it didn't end with a car chase.
Because
the next film we're going to talk about does have a car chase as well. So.
So you're just like disappointed that like it wasn't like to those like soaring heights that Pixar usually like has put itself in the past.
Okay, but the otters though, the otters at the end of the car chase, like
the otters.
Are you kidding me? That made the car chase worth it for me.
There are some very cute elements with the characters. Yeah. None of them broke out to me, but I think they used them all well. There was never a point where I felt like they wasted potential. Mm-hmm. Which is what Pixar does. They try to find as much as they can. Again, they try to find as much details as they can. I like the fact that Sigourney Weaver appears as herself.
That was so cool. That was awesome.
Nice little voice cameo there.
But yeah, I was alluding to like the next film here, which did have a car chase in the end of it. It was the Secret Life of Pets. And this was where I kind of like reached my limit with Illumination Entertainment. Because for those who don't know, Illumination is the people who's making like the Despicable Me and the Minions movies. And they moved on to Secret Life of Pets. It's like, okay, this could probably work. They got enough varied designs. They're going in a different direction with the story. They could find something new to explore through here. Problem is, they just end up doing mostly like a buddy picture, and not even that great of a buddy picture. Like, I never really got the plight. It just kind of felt like, you know, how like DreamWorks will just like go through like the beats of like the template and then not really capitalize on the central character elements, because this movie, it gets distracted at one point and veers off of the B plot about trying to find the dogs with what's her name voices the little white dog. She voiced the villain in Zootopia. The sheep character.
Voice the sheep.
Yeah, she plays this little white dog trying to save the two dogs lost, and she has like a great. There are some really great performances in here, by the likes of like Albert Brooks and what's his name, Dana Carvey.
Mm.
Surprisingly, like I didn't think Dana Carvey could do a voice that could like mask his usual stuff, because he's he's not really a master of disguise. So. Yeah, I had to get that joke in. What did you think of The Secret Life, Bets?
Decent enough, like, about what I would expect from them, you know? Just, like, decent. Nothing, like, really great. Nothing really mediocre all that much, you know? It's, like, it's got all the stuff you can, like, predict about it. It's got, like, the wacky characters that are, like side characters that, like, you know are going to be in there, that you know are just going to be there for, like, a visual gag here and there, you know? It's got Kevin Hart in there doing wacky voices, which... Oh, man. I'm not the biggest Kevin Hart voice.
It's Kevin Hart doing Kevin Hart. So, yeah. Pretty much.
I guess when this movie first came out, I wanted to see it, but I think my filter is too strong because I couldn't bring myself to, like, watch this one. Like, I love, like, the little animal tropes, but I just didn't, I didn't get this one. Like, the trailers were like, oh, no.
Like, just didn't sell for you?
No, these are going to be, like, some trash doggy things and dumb things that dogs do. Well, anyone who owns a pet knows the dumb things that dogs do, like...
Well, I will give it that. If you don't own pets, like, this movie's very hard for you to relate
irrelevant.
To.
Yeah.
It is, because I think at least for me, the best part of the movie is just the bookended segments of when they start off these little short vignettes of, like, you know, when we leave, what do these pets do? And, like, some of them, like, a bird pretends that he's flying on an HDTV, and there's a dog that rubs his butt with, like, a blender or something like that. You know, these cute little things that can make for shorts, and that's what they put in the trailer. And I thought, yeah, this is a... cute trailer. It's not really going to hold the film, and they never really play up on that until the end when they get home, when the owners actually come home and they visit their animals. The thing is, though, these animals are running all over the city, and no humans seem to really notice or even present in the city.
Where'd they go?
And, unless they're,
I think,
like,
the writing angles that, like, this, like, they're all out for the whole day, you know, and, like, they don't know what the pets are doing when, like, they're, like, out and about, you know?
I like to imagine there's, like, a national emergency and everyone had to leave the city. Because no one seems to question it, especially during the scene where there's a car chase where, like, isn't there, like, a rabbit driving a bus at some point?
Yes, there is.
Yeah. It's also surprisingly violent, too. Like, Kevin Hart plays this this rabbit who's been betrayed as a pet and has started this underground gang of pets devoted to killing all humans. And... And eventually it ends with, like, there's a scene where they end up killing an alligator at some point. And it is so bizarre. I wish we could follow that up with something better, but we got to talk about Ice Age 5.
I just
Neil deGrasse Weasel.
I just filtered out these movies. Like I did not... I haven't seen the last two Ice Ages. Like, are you kidding me? I saw one and two, and then I might have seen part of three, and I saw the shorts. I've watched the shorts. And then I was like, I'm done.
Can those dumb animals just go extinct already? I swear.
Like, or are they still living?
Like, these are turning into Land Before Time films. Because they never stop. Ever. I forgot what this is called. I think it's called Collision Course.
Collision Course, yes.
Yeah, because it involves a meteor that's going to hit the Earth, and they decide that in order to stop the meteor, there are apparently magnetic fragments of a meteor that if they gather enough of them, it'll bounce the magnet off Earth.
What?
And they're all close enough to each other, but at the same time while they're doing this, Manny has to deal with being Manny has to deal with his daughter marrying somebody.
Yep.
I was going to say he has to deal with the fact of being a grandfather, but I imagine they're saving that for the sixth film.
Because mammoths have wedding ceremonies.
Because they set up the fact that, like, Diego's settling down and he wants to have kids, and they never really build anything on that. And Sid is trying to deal with the fact that he can't find a woman yet, which he's been doing for every film and still doesn't find one here. So, wow, they are padding this out for the long haul.
I know.
What are they going to... I'm trying to think, because every single scenario they avoid the apocalypse, somebody wants these characters to die. And I think it's me.
That's going to be the last animated short. It's just going to be the explosion.
Well, I'm thinking, what's left? There's got to be, like, either...
They've done dinosaurs. They've done, like, the meltdown.
They've done the meltdown. They've done, like, the flood. They've done they did the dinosaur thing. They did the iceberg thing. The only thing I can think of left is that there's going to be a volcano explode, or they're going to starve to death. So come back for Ice Age leftovers.
Rise of the Vultures.
In which all the animals starve to death and Manny tries to come to terms with being a grandfather. I swear if that ends up being the film. So I guess we got to talk about the sausage party in the room.
Oh, yes.
Now,
you know what? This is like one that we were like... You were, like, particularly, like, dreading this one.
Yep.
Like last year, like, the trailers were coming out for it.
Because the script had leaked for this, and the thing is, like, if there's anyone who would like to see more R-rated animation, it's me. I adore animation that it should explore other areas. Problem is, I didn't really dig as much, because, honestly, it's just Seth Rogen's usual deal of trying to, like, force in his own little allegory and then just make weed and fart jokes the whole time. And it's like, I kind of viewed this film, you know, a lot of people think, oh, it's brilliant because it's a satire and it's provocative. And I'm just like, this is Rogan's usual stick. And it's just, yeah, it's an animation.
Like, I'm all for provocative satire, but you can only, like, sexualize food so much. Like,
that's what I was thinking, too. Everyone thinks it's, like, it's X-rated all because the food had sex. It's like, it's food rubbing up on each other and pretending that they're having sex. It's like,
yeah, that's all it is. Like, I was even shocked. When I think back about that, I'm not even, like, surprised that they kept in the orgy sequence with all the food.
Yeah. Supposedly
they were going to, like, cut it out because, like, that they had to or something, but nope, they work it in.
No. That, from what I understand, they only had to edit one thing, which is because one of the food had pubes. And they just had to edit that out, and then everything else was fine for the R.
That had to go? That was it?
That was it, because there really is no, like genitals, or most stuff's implied, and it's food, so you could get away with it, you know? Mm-hmm. Like, imagine someone's going to post, like, you know, here's a reenactment of it, and they're just going to have, like, hot dogs and buns.
But yeah, like, all around that and stuff, it just feels like the movie's, like, going for, like, the world record for, like, most curse words in a single film.
Well, they promote it as trying to be a very adult film, but most of the jokes in the film are food puns. And not even, like, good food puns. These are, like, the ones that, like, DreamWorks and Pixar would throw out because they're lame. I mean, honestly, a Meatloaf song sung by Meatloaf? We were making that joke in grade school. Why are they making this here?
Character walks into, like, a Mexican cantina and makes a joke about, like, there being, like, illegal, like, products in here or something.
Yeah.
A bunch of, like, salsa, like...
Oh. Yeah, the sauerkraut wants to exterminate the orange juice.
Mm-hmm.
these are all very
this film's right up your alley, at least.
You got one guy.
Yeah, you guys are loving it.
This is my movie.
Well, at least we know it has some fans.
Because
they cut corners and made deals.
They it's true. Because, like, I saw the budget for this film, I looked up the budget, said, like, it was $19 million, and I'm like, that's BS. There's no way they paid $19 million for animation this good. Norm of the North cost $19 million. It did not look this good. And I found out, okay, it was done by, I believe it was done by the same company that worked on the Thomas the Tank Engine, and they were not equipped to handle this, that a lot of animators got frustrated and just ended up quitting, and they ended up not getting paid.
Oh, yeah, that, like, really soured me on this film when I heard that.
So they just took a lot of, like, half-completed work and then just kept like abusing artists along the way, and then just like more half completed work. And
I think I saw like a short documentary, like a bit of a short documentary about those animators that got screwed over. And I recall the quote they opened up with from one of them, where he said that like I spent like 60 hours a week animating a cartoon sausage, having sex with other products. Like I love, and I didn't get paid for any of it. I love my work in like Hollywood. It's just depressing.
Yeah, they don't want to pay animators. Huh?
I know, right?
They don't want to pay for that quality of their hot dog sex. But moving on to something a little bit, we haven't really talked about a great film. Let's talk about Kubo and the Two Strings. My favorite film of last year. Because, again, like, I was apprehensive about it because it's like animation. And like, it does really good films, but they've never done a film that made me believe that they are doing a masterpiece. Mainly because their technical work is off the charts.
Mm-hmm.
Brilliant. And I was hoping, like, Kubo, I was hoping that it could touch on something big here, and it does. It has this great theme about storytelling and family, and it has these amazing sword fights and these magical scenes and origami doing, I mean, stop motion origami, these tiny little origami things they had to animate. It's like, jeez, pushing themselves so much with this. Yeah,
it is pretty. Yeah, it is exactly that.
The action scenes in this film specifically, like usually during like a lot of animated film scenes, you get bored by those like dramatic fights or the like, let's show the strength of our hero kind of things, or let's show them the struggles they have to go through. Well, these were all intricate. These were all entertaining. Like every single action scene that we had was like, we were actually thinking like, are they going to make it? Like, this is really intense.
And it's all like supplemented by like the direction and the lighting and whatnot and every single like technical aspect they put into it to make it feel like, you know, a genuine work of art as film.
Yeah. And again, yeah, because they don't actually stop the film for these like sequences. Like the first scene where Monkey is battling with the evil witch sisters, we get this great dialogue that reveals her backstory while they're fighting here. So like there's still like no throwaway dialogue here. Like you're still getting storytelling here while you're watching this amazing scene where they're jumping through the air in a rainstorm, slicing at each other with swords.
Yeah, the entire way that they reveal story within the entire story of Kubo and the Two Strings is astounding, because it's always like those moving the plot forward points, but we have it like told through intricate ways. We have several dramatic reveals, and I felt that I didn't anticipate any of them. Like, the twist of Monkey, I didn't see him coming. Like,
well, you can kind of sense it, but they do their best.
You can make correlations, but...
You can make the correlations, but the thing is, you can only make those correlations if you read their actions very specifically.
Yeah, the visuals.
Like,
the build-up can feel a little weird, but, like, the payoff is, like, sure, you can see it coming, but, like, you appreciate it.
Yeah,
so.
And this is where, like, if you're a parent, you will see it immediately. Because, like, that first scene with Monkey and Kubo in the cave, you look at the mannerisms, and you're like, oh... I think I know. I'm pretty sure I know what's going to happen here. And there's a later scene where Kubo wakes up both Monkey and Beetle. And the way that they wake up, you're like, oh, okay. I'm pretty sure this is what's going to happen. It's a clever reveal, because usually, like with these films, they tend to reveal a twist pretty early just so like kids will be able to catch up with it. But they have enough faith that, you know, kids will keep up with the story here.
Yeah.
And I think it helps that they keep the story fairly light. You know, it's just about Kubo trying to find this armor and a sword so that he can defeat the evil Moon King. Fairly simple story, and then they weave in, like, a family's, a clan's desire for revenge.
Like, it gets heavy at the very end. Like, the weight of the entire story that you've carried as a viewer, that you've carried, like, growing with these characters, like, finally, like, comes off your shoulders in like, the final moments of this film.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. It's heavy themes, but it's told very lightly where most kids can easily relate to it.
Adventure-esque, like the hero adventurer going through the story.
Yeah. Also, great voice acting by Charlize Theron and Matthew McConaughey on this.
Oh, excellent.
They are perfect.
They really poured themselves into these roles.
Which, you think Matthew McConaughey, you think he would ham it up a little too much. But no, he's actually surprisingly subtle in this role for playing a really dumb character.
Yeah, I thought it's some accent in there or something, like his usual shtick, you know? But like, no, it doesn't come through at all.
You guys have to talk about the music in this film. Like the music in Kubo and the Two Strings, so amazing. Like even the roll credits, like the theme music in between. I love the soundtrack to this movie. I'm really into soundtracks in films, and this one is just like they poured a lot, like culturally, into this, which is so good.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. They completely sell the whole Japanese folklore thing. It doesn't feel like they're trying to adapt it. It feels like they understand this completely from every tiny little angle. Like also like just even the tiniest things of the animations. Like my favorite character was the old woman who befriends Kubo. Like just looking at, like for a stop motion film, looking at like the little wrinkles on her face and how they would have to make that into like 3D animation just to get that just right. Like, jeez. Man, just trying to think like how they went about this. And I love the fact that at the very end, they have enough confidence to pull back the curtain and show you that giant visual effect of the huge skeleton monster that they assembled.
Because like, wasn't that like the biggest, like creation like Laika has made so far for a movie?
Oh yeah. The biggest character, at least.
That's got to go in their lobby.
The biggest...
Knowing them, I would totally put that in the lobby and just like have, like point to everyone coming in like, yeah, we made that. That's what you invest in with Laika.
The biggest character they've ever made, and with the little origami guy, the smallest character they've ever made.
Oh my gosh.
Oh yeah.
Yep.
Microscopic.
He goes right at the top of the skeleton right there.
Did anyone see the wildlife?
No.
Awesome. We're never going to talk about it. It was another one of those, like, Lionsgate will want to try to get into animation, so they'll try to grab something from Germany or Russia and try to push it out there. And this was like a little Robinson Crusoe thing with cute, funny animals. Never really took off. I think it made decent money, but nobody really paid attention to it.
No.
So moving on. Storks.
Hey, diversity.
What for?
For in Storks, like there's diversity, so that was, you know.
Yeah, there's pink-haired and blue-haired babies.
Yeah, I guess there's that.
I was thinking Storks. I initially didn't have much faith in, but I kind of liked how they went about it. I think they realized they trusted the audience enough that you know that you would get the story that you wouldn't want to that you really don't care how they power the machine that makes the babies. Like they kind of relate to it. They don't. Mm-hmm. They don't spend most of their time explaining why parents stopped using the baby-making machine from the Storks to deliver babies and went to, you know, an Amazon service. You know, they leave it mostly up to your imagination. But I was surprised how well the humor was written in this. Like, there are scenes that made me laugh just how for their assembly. And they're actually rather clever. Like, Key and Peele voice a wolf pack that are basically this wolf pack that they are so well assembled that they can create anything by bonding together like Voltron to create anything. Like in order to get...
And they audibly like say the sound effects as they like click, click, click.
At one point to get across a cliff, they end up forming a bridge to get across, but not a traditional bridge. They make a suspension bridge with wolves. very ridiculous.
Yeah, give them credit. They like did more than like you'd think they would do with like a film like this.
Yeah, there's surprisingly good voice acting from this too. I mean, I gotta give Kelsey Grammer credit. I don't think anyone could say a line like "I'm gonna destroy the baby making factory" with both cynicism and ridiculousness in her voice. Without cracking up, like he sells it perfectly.
Yeah,
that's my favorite point of the movie where he's just piloting this giant piece of machine. He's like, "I'm gonna destroy the baby machine." God. I want that tape.
Do you want to listen to just a whole reel of him laughing and laughing himself off?
I will frame that tape. I was surprised though. Like, why would parents give up the baby making machine? You can have your baby have any hair color you want. They have babies that have green and pink hair and blue hair. And why would you give that up? I don't know. I guess Amazon is better stuff than kids. So,
hey, free shipping on like purchases over a certain amount. So that's nice. You can't beat that.
Oh. Trolls.
Stellar movie.
Stellar?
Yeah, I love this movie. I think there's a lot of lacking in like female positivity for a lot of films.
Mm-hmm.
Like something that seems overly prevalent in this. I like to do like when I watch a lot of movies, I'll do like, oh, well, how do these interrelate? And what major themes do I see throughout several of these films? Mm-hmm. Well, something that I see in several of these films is like leaving the woman behind or like what she thinks is inferior or what she does is inferior in some way, shape, or form or not warranted. Of like attention. And so in the Trolls movie, we kind of see the fruition of like a female's identity, a female's like perspective, like being good, being right, being helpful, being something that other people should think about and consider it. And then we see it shape and develop another female character. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, oh my gosh, so cute, so precious. The music is interesting. Campy as heck, though. Like, I did not want to see this movie when it first. And then I, like, built up an intrigue to it.
Yeah, my eyes got a cavity from watching
this. So sugar sweet. Oh, my gosh.
From how much glitter there was. It's surprising, though, because, like, I wish that it just, like, because, yeah, they show how it clashes between, like, two characters of, like, the
really positive princess and the really cynical, like, other troll that she, like, has to help her, like, rescue her people.
Yeah, and I mean, it goes between having, like,
to, like, come in and, like, save their butts.
The mm-hmm. quest of saving her people and then having this sort of, like, Cinderella plot of a woman trying to get noticed in the, what are they called? Not the trolls, but the,
Bergen?
The Bergen. Bergens,
yeah.
Yeah, there's this one female Bergen. It's like, okay, these are both great arcs. My only problem is that they don't really have a flow to them. It's just like one stops for the other at one point. Because like at one point it stops becoming about let's save our people. It's like let's help this Bergen get in good conscience with the prince here. It's like okay, this is a neat arc. I just wish it didn't come in the middle and then stop and then come back.
I think that's an identity thing for the trolls. Unfortunately, like they're so easily distracted by shiny things. Like. Mm-hmm. There is, like, the hazard of the Bergens coming, and they throw a party. And at any time, they want to, like, hyper-celebrate, throw a party in glitter and sparkles. Mm-hmm. And, like, everything is like, oh, my gosh, there's a squirrel distraction. And we have the other troll. What is his name?
Branch,
who kind of gives us the more realistic perspective and kind of, like, I mean, there's, like, an equivalent exchange going on here between Branch and, like, Princess Troll. And they have to learn not to just, like, jump at every distraction, but to, like, gauge. And you're right, there is like this like weird like stop and go in the plot because she has no idea how to do that. Her people have no idea how to do that. I don't know how he learned to do that, probably the loss of his relative.
Yeah, there's that angle to it.
Yeah. And I get the part because like they still try to build up character through there.
Yeah.
I just felt like it turned into like a completely different movie at that point.
Yeah, I didn't expect the Bergens to have anything happening in their lives.
Yeah.
Identity, I didn't.
Yeah, and I mean, it wraps up the usual way, you know, song and dance number.
Yeah, everyone's happy.
Song, dance, happiness, love with each other, saves the day.
Pretty much guaranteed.
Blah.
I think I recommend seeing it if you like, I don't want to say body positivity. What do I want to say? Like if you like feeling fulfilled by, like, happy things. Like, everyone likes the dark, edgy, like, post-apocalyptic, like, scary, oh my gosh, we gotta overcome this, like, atrocity. Mm. But, like, seeing something happy and overcoming a small struggle and being happy at the end of that, like, I don't know.
I guess if you just want to be happy, this film will, like, give that to you
in spades.
I mean,
it's uplifting.
Spades.
Yeah, it's the, I would say it's the
uplifting. It's not really going to piss off parents at all.
So not really.
Very, pretty safe film. Sugary film, man.
One big sugar rush, really.
Yeah. So much freaking glitter.
Kind of like back when Wreck-It Ralph days, honestly.
Yeah.
Moana?
Oh. Ooh.
Talk about music again. Nice. Oh my gosh, Moana.
Yeah, initially when I first saw the film, I thought it's a great film, but because it was the two guys who was it Clements and the guys who made the Little Mermaid and Aladdin. Mm-hmm. So they worked on the film, and I'm like, okay, yeah, this is a very good film, but is it as good? Is it classic? Because I thought, like, well, you know, it's really good, but is it going to be on that classic level? And then about 2 days after seeing it, You're Welcome started popping into my head.
I
started hearing that song more and more. And at the time, I thought, like, it's an okay song, but I don't think it gelled with me. And then the more I kept thinking about, like, no, wait, this is an earworm. It's staying there. This is going to be
Thank
a classic you. At that point.
I know. Good job getting Lin-Manuel Miranda on this
right?
film.
Oh, my goodness.
He and, like, all the other songwriters really delivered their, like, they're all here.
Yeah. Well, I mean, yeah, they haven't really faltered. Even, like, Princess and the Frog they worked on still has its merits for memorable numbers. I still sing Are You Ready? I think, well, yeah, my favorite song is I'm Shiny, just because I think...
God, the trash song? For
Jermaine Clements, just singing it.
For one, it's a very catchy song. It's a very fun song, and at the same time, it does a great job at being a reveal song of the backstory of Maui. And yeah, I guess the film is pretty much perfect on every level, from establishing Moana, how she goes there. The only thing I really had an issue with, which I kind of let go after a while, was the inconsistency of the water of the magic.
How
it comes and goes in her life and how it affected her life. I think they wanted it to be its own, like, you know, how it's represented in, like in the Avatar series. It's a hard to control kind of thing. It's of its own entity, and we have to learn to work with it. But I wish they would have gone into more explanation of it. Like,
true.
Yeah. Oh, she was kind and the water saw that?
Wait. And I thought that at first, but then the more I thought about how they would try to explain that, I'd be like, nah, that scene really wouldn't quite work. So yeah, I think they made the good call by not putting that
just
in.
Just make the assumption like the ocean has like an attitude or something.
Yeah.
It's sassy. It doesn't want to deal with.
Yeah.
It's like, why didn't you help me there, ocean? You didn't say the magic word.
Also, there's a lot of like problems with like cultural appropriation, but they really did their research with this film in terms of like the people who are Voyagers, which is amazing.
The film builds up like a great mythology to like here and stuff. It really hooks you in, really does.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I just love the adventure aspect of it too, you know, this like grand adventure across like wide open seas. Like, you feel like you're watching like myth like progress in front of you, you know.
Yeah.
Not just like our European princess story or anything like that, you know, but just like a journey between like two people who genuinely want to like help each other out, you know, who want to like improve each other and reclaim some kind of like glory for each other, you know.
Yeah, and for your whole people.
Yeah, like, for your own people, too.
For reclaiming the entire like identity of who they were. They were I don't want to say the word. Oh my gosh, did I already say the word? I think I said the word. Spoiler.
We were Voyagers!
We were Voyagers!
She screams it enough, so I can understand it gets so stuck in your head.
No, but you really get behind Moana. You really get behind Maui. I love both of them to death.
My daughter is obsessed with this film, and I have not tired of it yet.
That's
so
awesome.
It's that
so it's
good.
Done something right there.
Well, if you haven't seen it, Mom and Dad are still in the picture. So, I mean, that's
well,
a
Mom and Mom and Dad are in the picture, but they more or less come at the end. Because, like, the thing is...
we don't have the Frozen problem with the mysterious...
Well, the thing is, people complain about the fact that parents die, but that's because there has to be either two things. If the parents do not play a central role in the plot, they either have to be left behind or they have to die.
Yeah.
It's one or the other, and usually they end up saying they die because that's then people the typical, stop asking, well, where's their mom? Where's their dad? Why doesn't mom or dad come to help?
Just
why doesn't dad do it? It's like,
right,
look, they're dead, okay?
They're gone.
Fine, separate. They're not coming back. another one takes place kind of at sea here is the Red Turtle.
Ooh.
I didn't get to see this one. I wanted to see it so bad.
This is kind of more on the limited release side, but... I was surprised how, like, it worked all right, I think, as a silent film. I don't think it quite got to that level of establishing. I think it was trying to establish heavier themes in that film more than it could establish through a silent film.
Mm-hmm.
I felt like they were missing a few components to this. And it was mostly just, you know, watching these grand visuals of this really bizarre, mostly a very surreal story, especially for, like, a Ghibli production. Another one, I doubt anyone saw this too, because this one snuck in around the same time, was Miss Hakusai. It was released by Universal. It's about the wife of this famous artist. And it's mostly a true story. It's mostly just they try to find stuff for this woman during this particular era in Japan of trying to become an artist. And she mostly has this kind of like, you know, kind of like bored expression on her face, and she goes through all these like weird situations where she ends up seeing ghosts. She's obsessed with watching fires when they happen, that she has to rush over to when a house is on fire and watch it. She struggles with trying to draw and how to make a drawing perfectly. She struggles with her blind sister and trying to come to terms with that. The problem is, like, it goes between all these different vignettes and her trying to find a boyfriend too. And it's just sort of like, it's not really a story. It's just like, here's some weird stuff that happened in her life. And then it kind of just, it felt like this film couldn't pick a tone too, because it begins with her talking about her life. And it looks like traditional Japan. And then a guitar riff comes through. And like, okay, not too sure about this film. So we'll move on to some of the most people have seen, which is Sing.
Otherwise known as You Will Only Remember This Film for the Songs.
And this was the last straw with me for Illumination, because here they have completely bypassed the middleman in getting to the song and dance number that they usually get to.
Why not start in the theater?
Why not start?
Let's just do it.
Yeah.
They establish way too many characters in this film. Way too many. There's like, what, like 8, 9, 10, 12 characters they establish?
Yeah, big seeing. Cast, yeah.
And
it's, it is a lot.
It feels like way too much for essentially a very classic type of storytelling. It's like, hey, let's put on a show and save the theater.
Right, and they try to like interweave all of them together and have them all have like really meaningful plots, you know, yeah, and
definitely
like want to care
of, like,
about
the
each
Muppets,
of them.
Honestly.
Yeah.
The
problem with that,
movies.
Though, is that like you dedicate so little time to each, you know, that each one does wrap up, but it doesn't feel like satisfying by the end.
No,
like,
and
they leave out so much that you that they could
story.
Have done.
Hey, Porcupine's story. I can't remember her name, but her story felt great. I mean, I followed her. She had enough scenes for me to feel like I could, like, vicariously live through this character. Mm-hmm. Whereas, like, I'm so terrible with these animal names. Like,
just say the animal.
The mom pig.
The mom pig.
Oh, my
pig.
Gosh. She got,
Rosita.
Like,
I
well, talking about
I
women
that?
To the wayside. This woman got, like, nothing and, like, ended with nothing and, like, got to perform once, I guess. Wow, is that all she really wanted in life?
She just wanted to be a star because at that point...
We're kind of just, like, told that's what she wants, you know. That's what she was.
At that point in
Isn't
the movie...
Isn't that what any woman wants?
I think,
yikes.
Yeah, at that point...
Yikes.
She should get a better husband.
She wanted attention and admiration, but like this was more like sort of like the goals of the individual and then the grander goal, which is like wanting to be a star.
How they all came together under this the roof of the theater.
Right. Mm-hmm. The problem is they bypass through several of these interesting angles that are never explored. Like at one point, she realizes, I have to be at rehearsals on this day, but... I have to be there early and I can't, you know, take care of my kids and get everything ready for dinner.
Oh my gosh,
so overnight, she somehow gains an engineering degree and fractures this like Rube Goldberg device to like get her kids off to school and get her husband dinner on the table through all this machinery. It's like,
when did this happen?
No
connect
here, she could have developed communication skills with her husband. That could have been a huge like herring moment where they like connected and then maybe she skipped rehearsal.
But no, here's funny machines
but no,
that do stuff.
Like, I mean, women can do everything. They can handle it on their own because they
watch,
don't need help.
It's that kind of film you watch where like you can think of so many other better things that could have done with each individual single character. Like if the film can do that and like make you wonder all about that, then you got to wonder like what did I even get from this to begin with? Because
you're asking more questions. Than
I know,
the
and you're
answers.
Wanting more from it. You know,
it's like I have no faith in Illumination now. None, it's gone.
The singing was okay.
Yeah, the numbers were huge. I cared about some of it.
The singing is good by everyone except the elephant trying to sing Leonard Cohen. And again, like, this is a character they do not have any time for, this shy character they set up that they can sing and then build her up to singing. She has no time that she literally has to say, I'm shy, to get her plot across.
Mm.
That's how much little time this movie has. And it's been so much time trying to hit all these beats that you don't really care for anyone at this point. You're just kind of watching characters go through the motions. Like, I should feel something for this koala trying to save his theater that is... Dad.
Yeah, I didn't really care for his like struggle.
No,
which was so weird. Like, because usually these kind of movies, and I'm like, oh my gosh, well, musicals.
I know I couldn't get a train on him and stuff. Like, I kept having this like inkling that he had like this selfish obsession to it too.
Yeah,
because they don't develop him enough.
How many of you guys go to Marcus Theaters? Just quick. Anyone go to Marcus Theaters? Some of you see creepy goblin guy who owns Marcus Theaters every once in a while. I love him, and his numbers are interesting, but like he's got to stop just like forcing himself on his theater public. Like, it's really hard. That's who, like the main theater guy in Sing reminded me of. The koala reminded me of Marcus Theaters guy, and I'm just like, oh my God, sir.
I
got to
meet Marcus Theaters guy. There's an interesting story to tell
there. Go to Marcus Theater. It's before, any major production.
I'm going to look up on Twitter and find him.
Goober. Seriously. Greg, is that his
But
name?
Yeah, that's... The problem with that is that I never really felt like I got this idea that he was supposed to be like more of like a scoundrel and how he kind of like exits out the window and steals electricity.
Yeah.
The problem is they try to make him so likable.
Genuine and lovable, yeah.
You never get this point where you kind of want to admire him as this great deceiver.
Mm-hmm.
Because they're trying to make all the characters as cute and cuddly as they can that they never really... develop into anything more than that.
But I think the production though just realized that if they went along with that where it was just like thieving and conniving and just learned his lesson in the end, they figured that would be way too predictable.
Yeah.
But again, the sin here is that they did not go into a better way.
But he didn't like learn anything about himself either.
Not really, no. And the one thing I will give the film credit for is they did not take the Minions route where they focused on, like, these one little mascot. Like, and they have plenty of opportunities to. You know, they had, like, the little Japanese dogs that kept coming and singing, and they had the squids that would light up and light the stage, and I thought, oh no, they're gonna overtake the film, and they never do. But that's only because the film is crowded with so much other crap; it doesn't have time for it.
Mm-hmm.
There you go. Let's talk about Rock Dog.
Oh boy,
did you see Rock Dog?
No, I did not go see Rock Dog.
You didn't go see the Chinese hit Rock Dog?
Couldn't do it.
Yeah, this is a...
I feel like there's more interesting stuff about the production of the film rather than, like, the actual film itself.
It's surprisingly not bad. It's not great. I mean, it's essentially a dog, a mastiff who lives in this village defending it and decides, I want to go to the city and sing and be a rock star. And he goes to learn from a cat rock star voiced by Eddie Izzard, which... Pretty good. You know, Eddie Izzard does a great job.
I love Eddie Izzard and stuff, but, like...
I love this film more for what it doesn't do. Mm. Like, it never... Because it's a dog and a cat, they never make the obvious jokes. There's never a scene where, like, the cat's sitting in a litter box. There's never a scene where, like, the dog plays fetch with his guitar or something like that. They're smart enough to know to give these characters personalities beyond these simple little jokes. The most relation, I think, to the cat thing is that he has... little robotic mice as his guards. That's about it. And it's mostly a straight story. I wish I could like it more, especially because Lewis Black voices the villain. But it had me questioning because, okay, so the dog is defending is built up by his father, voiced by J.K. Simmons. Great. To defend this village by basically using Kung Fu Panda skills. But the dog decides, I don't want to be in a Kung Fu Panda film. I want to go to the city. And it made me think, like... Because the dog has to defend the village from wolves because it's a village of sheep. And I thought, okay, so the dogs are at war with the wolves for the sheep. So he goes to the city, and we discover that the wolves have their own, like, fight club business, and they own their own corporation and suits and everything. I'm like, and they really still care about this one village of sheep? Couldn't they just order, like, you know, sheep food in the mail? Or is, like, are sheep forbidden? Or
hit up Sheep Amazon.
Yeah, they could plunge into that.
If only. And it's only just there so that they can have a little bit of a fight scene at the end. I wish I could like this movie more, but it's decent. It's one of those films you can watch with your kids and you won't get a headache mm-hmm. about how bad it is. Because it had potential. Lego Batman. Oh, yes.
If you've wanted, like, every in-joke ever about, like, Batman ever, this is your film.
I didn't realize that counted as 2016. Is that really? I thought that was out, like, so...
We're doing between now and last end.
Yeah, between now and last panel. All right. So, yeah, this film counts inside
That's
there.
That's fair.
Yeah, and people want to talk about...
And a very good one to put in there, too.
Lego Batman. Because, yeah, this is one of those that, like, it appeals to both people very familiar with Batman and people who know nothing about Batman. Because there's that scene where Joker's listing off every single villain there. And everyone, even if you don't know who they are, you're cracking them up just because the mere sight of them is hilarious. And it's just like, yep, they're all real. You can go look them up and Google them.
I never thought I'd see Condiment King again, but here he is finally getting his love.
Here we got
ketchup and mustard and all.
I liked how they would try to force as much as they could in there. Like, they have the scene with, like, Killer Croc. I did something in this movie.
But no, what I love about it, though, is that it continues what they did with the previous Lego movie and that they keep the pace, like, so fast, but they plug in, like, so many, like, jokes and gags that, like, you really want to, like, go back and rewind and, like, rewatch the film over and over again.
This film is going to be endlessly rewatchable for DC fans more than anything.
Mm-hmm.
The only aspect I thought that... And it's maybe because they added in too much. I wish they spent some more time with the Justice League. Just because I thought...
Because there was so much, like, there was so much layer of stuff they could do with that.
Because I wish it would have been... Because we spend a little bit of time with the Justice League, though. I would have just been cool if they had that scene where he gets to the party and we just kind of see them briefly and then just, like, shut the door on Batman. Because that's essentially what they're doing, except we go into the party and we see the Flash and Martian Manhunter and Wonder Woman. They're all cracking jokes all over the place, like, oh, cool, they're going to play some role in the big climax where there's a huge fight, never show up again. It's like, man, like,
it plays out more like a visit to like an office like party or something, and like the one awkward quiet guy comes in, you know, and just plays out exactly like that.
But at the same time, yeah, I do like the ending where they basically go by Lego logic and throw all the other villains into it.
Yeah.
Surprisingly, though, because at one point, one of the villains they include is Voldemort. And what's surprising is that Ralph Fiennes is voicing Alfred, but he's not voicing Voldemort.
There was a great opportunity.
I think, isn't it Eddie Izzard who's voicing Voldemort in that scene? It's someone else who's fairly notable about it, so. So, Lego Batman. I did like the fact, though, that they didn't go back to describing the whole breaking the fourth wall of, like, you know, what's under
thing,
there.
Yeah.
I thought, like, oh, no, they're going to go back and they're going to overuse the show. But no, they have enough faith where, like, you know what will happen if they go down this route.
Yeah, yeah.
They have enough faith in the audience, so.
Yeah, they trust that you're up to date with your Lego movie canon.
And as long as they respect the audience like that, I have faith in Ninjago this fall. So, looking forward to that.
Yeah, especially good for a property that I'm sure many people will not know a whole lot about.
No, and that's the cool thing is that I think it has a lot of potential there. Because, like, with Lego Batman, it's mostly just playing up towards, like, the satire of Batman and finding funny stuff to do around Batman. Ninjago is going to kind of be more of like an original type deal of trying to find its own legs, which makes me more curious about it.
Which is odd, though, because it already has its legs with like its cartoon and whatnot.
Through its cartoon, but I'm curious to see how it does with the general audience and how they make it work. The trailer looks amazing.
Yeah.
So I'm looking forward to this. Of course, the one thing everyone's going to be looking forward to is like, what villains are they going to put in there? Which, honestly, I could go either way. If the film works on its own, great. They don't have to break the fourth wall. They don't need to. The Boss Baby.
DreamWorks, you're better than this.
What has
been going on with DreamWorks lately?
Now, you say that, but this is kind of like the same deal as when DreamWorks did Home. Because just like Home, this was based on a children's short story that should have remained a short story. Because at first, I kind of relate it to the story because it's essentially about a kid trying to deal with the fact that he has a baby brother and viewing the baby as sort of a boss. You know, he runs the household, he holds like meetings in the middle of the night, and he basically dominates the room. And at first I thought, based on the trailer, because there's a scene where they're having a car chase in the backyard and they cut away from that and it's just like, you know, the kid's playing. It's like, oh, that's cute. It's like, okay. So maybe it's in the kid's head.
Yeah, you think.
Maybe it's a psychological thing where he's trying to get to know this kid, but they ignore that, and it turns into this really weird plot about a baby corporation trying to maintain their cuteness and prevent puppies from taking over their cuteness because there's apparently an immortal puppy that's going to like make people like puppies more, and this could take away attention from babies. But then it made me question, like, well, if the puppy's immortal, then won't people get used to the cuteness and won't that stagnate the dog market that people will go away from dogs to like the babies more? And it's like, why am I questioning this? What?
Maybe it's just,
to make baby jokes in a little baby suit. This should be like a Looney Tunes bit. Why is this happening?
Oh, but they didn't put any of that puppy stuff in the trailer because you all would have thought that would be bullcrap.
Yeah.
Let's be honest.
Yeah.
And then the reveal happened.
Yes. And the thing is, the film does work in these little vignettes where they kind of, because I like the idea of Alec Baldwin versing this kind of like baby executive as like as a Looney Tunes type character for like a 6-minute short. It's a great idea. It leads to some funny stuff. Like he's done some little funny shorts. I like this character in bits and pieces. I don't like the fact that I have to watch him go on this quest to save the baby formula from puppy cuteness in a not really explained universe. the same thing, it relates back to like Storks, except unlike Storks, Baby Boss spends so much of its time trying to explain this world that it becomes way too intricate. It's like, I don't really care about the immortal baby formula that makes them smart and immortal.
Did you go to Boss Baby to learn all about like this like big, happy, magical world? Yeah. Did you come here to watch like a good animated film?
I came here to watch a baby fart baby powder. So.
Well, if these are like for there you go. kids' interest to get them into kids' things, to drag parents to these movies, I mean, besides like other people like us who are interested in animated films, like think about what this is perpetuating for kids' ideas of like what storks are or what a younger sibling is like. Like, what is this perpetuating for kids watching these movies? Is maybe
like,
it's relatable.
Isn't like it just doesn't give much for them that's like new or like original or exciting or could improve them
and
in
that's,
any kind of way.
Yeah, I think because that remarks on a level that where they, the problem with the Boss Baby is that they mark a clear divide between the kids and the adults, because there are there's that moment where he comes up, it's like, oh, this is where babies come from? It's like, yeah, well, where'd you think they come from? It's like, what? Oh, no. And yeah, like that's a joke only the adults would get. And then there's other jokes that the Boss Baby makes only adults would get. Like, it's like, here, Boss Baby, insult this guy. Like, play pretend. Like, oh, you take that. What did you go to community college? These little jokes. And those are jokes that only like adults are going to get. I think the parents will probably be more entertained than this by the kids.
Yeah.
Especially towards the end of the film, like, because towards the end of the film, they want to pull back and go back to like that sentimentality of having a big brother. It's like, no, you didn't work towards this in the third act. You don't get to be that sentimental.
You don't deserve that.
No.
You don't get to be emotional about it.
You know, it's made so much money already. It's made so much money. I don't get it.
Because it's DreamWorks. They could poop on screen in the computer.
They could put a guy in underpants on screen and like it'll make money.
It just came out this weekend, but the Smurfs, The Lost Village. I doubt anyone here saw that. So I'll just say that it's thankfully not the catastrophe that was like the previous two Smurfs films where it's live action. This one's completely CG. Was that?
There were two.
There were two? Yes.
There was only one of them.
I know,
and
they need to be reminded?
No, forget that. This is the only Smurfs movie.
Yes, forget about that.
This is it's a fully CG movie. And to be fair, this film is the most faithful to the Smurfs show. Like, it adheres very much to its lore and its magic and the designs and what Gargamel did and how Gargamel reacted with Azrael as cat. The only problem is I didn't really think that highly of the Smurfs as a kid. So I'm like, yeah, this is the Smurfs, and it's about as faithful as you're going to get. Okay, can we use this as an excuse to stop it? Because, like, and again, like, there's a great theme. Like, they touch on an interesting story aspect, which is, you know, like, how do we define Smurfette? Because they establish her that Smurfette was the creation of Gargamel through clay, and we don't really know her purpose. And then she goes out, and she finds, like, this whole village of female Smurfs. And then she tries to find her purpose through there. And essentially, it boils down to saying that, you know, Smurfette can be anything she wants to be. I just wish the film didn't literally have to say this at the end to the camera. Because at the same time, it's like, they establish very early on what Smurfette can do. She can absorb Gargamel's magic. And it's like, that's what she does. Why don't they define this? It's like, oh, well, she can be anything she wants to be.
Because women are mysteriously magical, remember? They can do everything.
Yes. Well, especially, like, I thought there'd be more of a clash, because when she gets to, like, the female Smurf village, they're mostly all just, like, warriors, and they train on, like, these dragonflies and whatever, and they have pikes and everything. And it made me thought there was going to be this divide between the Smurfs, but it's more just like, oh, they're female and male, and they kind of try to learn to connect, and it's about
they're
as far as it goes.
Two different cultures, though. Like, how do you not?
There's gonna be some kind of contrast there, you know? Like, Smurfs. We got Smurfs. Smurfberries.
It goes about as far as the TV show would go with that, which is just, you know, here's an interesting angle, but we're gonna use it just long enough just so we can get a little bit of a theme going here. Mm-hmm. And just like the cartoon, we'll blatantly put the theme at the bottom rather than let it proceed naturally, because honestly, I thought Smurfette was going to learn some new ability as the film went on and sort of come into her own as a character, especially because she goes through lots of these like training situations where I thought, oh, okay, she's going to find her niche through here. Nah, she just absorbs magic. And I really hate the ending where apparently, I didn't know this, apparently if Smurfs all hold their hands together and cry, they can revive the dead. So I learned something from the movie.
That sounds very familiar, actually.
Oh, they've got a use now. That's nice.
So I guess we're almost done here, but I wanted to talk about the road ahead for the rest of the year, which is not looking good.
No. Oh, boy.
I get paid to see these movies, but there are dark times ahead of me. Have to see, we got Cars 3, Despicable Me 3, The Emoji Movie.
No.
In which Patrick Stewart plays a piece of poop. The Nut Job 2. Oh. Is it sad that that's the only film I'm looking forward to just because I know it's going to be horrible trash and I just want to see?
Your Name is in theaters right now.
Yeah, true. Your name. We forgot to mention. Your Name is out.
Just came out this weekend.
Yep, so just came out. And only this weekend. So yeah, if you get a chance.
So this is the only time we can see it, I guess, in theaters as Americans.
Yeah, well,
it's all comes out on DVD.
Well, yeah, it's Funimation. And Funimation only do like weekend screenings and stuff. So. Mm-hmm. So catch it now because it's probably not going to be on DVD till like summer. So.
Ooh.
Oh, I can drive to that.
Oh, is it? At the Brooklyn?
Through Friday.
Brooklyn
okay.
Park
Ooh,
one. Okay.
Ooh, nice.
So is it going to be on next Friday or is that the last day?
Yeah. It's airing at both the Lagoon and the Regal.
I'm seeing that next Friday, and you'll see me there, guys.
I think that's our panel. I mean, I got my books up here. If anyone wants a copy, they come talk to me. And you guys want to say anything else? We got Horrors of Anime tonight at midnight. If you want to see some crazy shit.
Oh, that's going to be awesome.
Any other films we should mention before we're done? Oh,
Coco.
Thank goodness. Yes, the light at the end of the tunnel is Coco and hopefully Ninjago, but that's more towards the fall. I'm in for a bad summer. Please let Nut Job 2 have CGI Sai again.
I really want to see how this like pits against the Book of Life. Because like, my God, they're so similar. They look so freaking similar.
I say I'm looking forward to Nut Job 2, but that's in like a kamikaze. I don't care anymore. Make it as bad as you can.
I'm going to burn this all down.
Thank you.
Thank you all for coming. Have a great con.